Hello, in this video I will explain you the operating principle of the molten salt reactor and the thorium fuel cycle. Let's first look at a part of the nuclide charge containing the actinides. Along the vertical axis I've plotted the number of protons in a nucleus and along the horizontal axis the number of neutrons. Each row shows the isotopes of one particular element. The red box, for example, shows the isotopes of the element thorium. And the black or partly black squares indicate the isotope that can be found in nature. Thorium has only one natural isotope, namely thorium-232. Thorium-232 itself is not fissile and cannot be used as a fuel in a nuclear reactor. However, when it captures a neutron, the product, thorium-233, decays quickly to protactinium-233. Which decays with half-life of about 1 month to uranium-233. This uranium isotope is an artificial one, but is also highly fissile, just like uranium-235, that occurs in nature. In the thorium fuel cycle, we first need to convert thorium-232 into uranium-233, to fission this afterwards. Because we need one neutron to sustain a fission chain reaction and another one to convert thorium into uranium, we can have a sustained fission chain reaction only if the reactor is extremely efficient with neutrons. Fortunately, reactors like this exist, namely the molten salt reactor. This reactor consists of a large block of graphite, the grey oval shape in the plot, with channels in it. A fluoride salt, typically thorium fluoride and uranium fluoride dissolved in lithium beryllium fluoride, flows from bottom to top through the core and back through the heat exchanger. In the intermediate loop, indicated in blue, the heat is transferred to the energy conversion system to produce electricity or process heat. A small part of the salt is continuously tapped from the primary circuit to extract the fission products from the salt and to add fresh thorium. The safety philosophy of a molten salt reactor is rather different from that of a solid fuel reactor. In a solid fuel reactor, the operator tries to keep the fuel intact and to cool it at all times, even if the fission chain reaction has stopped, to avoid overheating due to the decay heat of the fission products. In a molten salt reactor, the salt is allowed to freely expand and flow. If the salt heats up too much, the freeze plug in the green pipe will melt and the salt will freely flow in the safe storage tanks beneath the reactor core. These can be cooled with water via natural convection or via another passive cooling mechanism to avoid overheating. On the other hand, we should take care not to cool the salt too much because we do not want it to solidify. The MSR has a strong power feedback coefficient, because of the nuclear Doppler effect and the expansion of the salt upon heating. Due to these mechanisms, the power drops sharply if one or more pumps would fail. The left figure shows the temperature of the salt if 4 out of 5 pumps would fail. The temperature rises only some few tenths of degrees, which directly leads to a sharp decrease of the reactor power, shown in the right figure. Surprisingly, also the opposite, an increase of pump power leads to a decrease of reactor power. This plot shows the reactor power of a critical molten salt reactor when the pumps are turned on. Because the precursors, these are the fission products that release a neutron after beta decay, are expelled from the reactor core, the reactor power decreases sharply. If after some tens of seconds the remaining precursors return to the reactor core, the reactor power increases again. One of the main benefits of the molten salt reactor is the composition of the nuclear waste it produces. This plot shows the radiotoxicity of spent fuel of a typical light water reactor. The red line is the contribution of the fission products, while the blue line is that of the plutonium and americium in the spent fuel. The horizontal line is the reference level, belonging to the natural uranium in the ore and its decay products. In a molten salt reactor, all actinides keep on recycling in the molten salt until they have been fissioned, And this means the actinides will not be present in the spent fuel from a molten salt reactor, leading to much shorter-lived nuclear waste. The reason for this can easily be seen in this plot. Because we start with thorium-232 as a breed material and uranium-233 as a fissile material, we need 4 neutron capture reactions before we produce neptunium and plutonium and other actinides. And this means these actinides are produced in much smaller quantities than in a light water reactor. The molten salt technology has already been demonstrated in the 60s of last century. The molten salt reactor experiment ran for 4 years in Oak Ridge with great success. However, this demonstration reactor contained not yet thorium in the salt, but operated on uranium and plutonium. In this test reactor, also the salt was not cleaned during operation. Nowadays, several European countries work together on the molten salt fast reactor, which has no graphite in the core. This reactor could also destroy the nuclear waste of current light water reactors. As a conclusion, we can state that a molten salt reactor is a very promising type of nuclear reactor, especially in combination with the thorium fuel cycle. It's inherently safe and produces much less long-lived nuclear waste. And thorium could fuel the world for thousands of years. Isn't that great?